We got this church. Everybody's still got that turkey hangover a little bit. All still struggling. Yeah, they say that's a myth. Everyone says turkey makes you sleepy, but it's actually the overeating. Any of us, if we committed that sin of gluttony this week, let's be honest. It was good. It was good. I hope that you had a good Thanksgiving week. And I just wanted to see you all back here. Please keep in prayer. We've got several who are still out of town and are traveling back. And it's just been a very busy weekend. And so we'll remember those. Just a couple of quick announcements. Next Sunday morning after the service, December 6th, we are having a business meeting for our members of our church. We'd ask that you stay a few moments and help with that. And then also, don't forget, on December 20th, we're super excited about it. We've got our kids' Christmas program that morning. It's called He Made a Way, and they have just started practicing, and they are going to be doing song. They're going to be reciting Bible verses by memory, and so we are excited to see that and how God has grown our children's ministry here in just a short time. Again, they are still in the midst of practices, so if there are any parents in here who you need to find out what that schedule is, see my wife, Miss Jamie, over in the corner sometime today. Or she also has a kids' Facebook page for our ministry there. You can search it. It's FBC Lakeland-FBC Kids. FBC Lakeland-FBC Kids. And the practice schedule is on there as well. We do have a couple prayer requests as we open the service this morning that we would like to ask. And Miss Lisa has brought a member of her family, Brother Terry Ramsey. He just did not get a good report at the doctor this week. High blood pressure, some issues with his heart. His kidney is functioning a little below half of what it should be. And so she is asking prayer for Terry and family this morning. And we'll do that. And then also, many of you knew her and you have been following the story that happened with our Polk City librarian here, the Dent family, Miss Suzette. She did pass Friday night in the hospital. And so we're going to pray for the Dent family this morning as well. What a horrible tragedy that was that they have been through, and that God would comfort them at this time. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you, the God of everything. Lord, we love you. Lord, I just thank you for another opportunity to come into your house to worship your name, the name above all names. No other name compares to you, Lord. Father, I do pray for Terry Ramsey this morning. I'm sure he's discouraged and just struggling. Lord, I just pray that you would comfort him. Lord, for these medications or different things that the doctors are going to put him through to try to get these levels back right. Lord, I just ask that they would work and that you would just be with the Ramsey family, Lord, and help comfort them and help them to just be able to lift him up in spirit. Lord, draw him close to you at this time. And Lord, we pray for the Benton family as well, that you would be with them as they have lost a wife, lost a mother, just a lady who was loved in our community here in Polk City. What a tragedy. Lord, I pray that you would be with her family. Lift them up and comfort them. Lord, I pray for these, I think it was three teens who were arrested and charged with this crime. Lord, I pray that you would be with them. Lord, I pray that they would come to know you. What glory you would give you through a tragic situation if you were able to save these three souls through these tragic circumstances. And so, Lord, I pray that you would work, heal this community. There have been so many that were touched by our life right now, Lord, and there's a void there. Lord, I pray that you would fill that void in our life. Lord, I just ask that you be with our service this morning, and just help us as we worship. Help us as we hear your message and your word preached, Lord, that we would be changed, that we would be lifted up, that we would be just comforted where we need comfort. Lord, you're the only one that can do that. No one else here can. So we need you. We need you in a desperate way this morning. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Well, good morning. I am not Kevin. Y'all need to pray for Kevin because he can't talk. And he called me in church and he says, hey, can you come sing? And I came and sang for y'all. So let's stand this morning as we begin our worship. And I feel like traveling off.
Traveling on, my heavenly home is. Leaning on the everlasting.
him.
Precious Jesus, save your friend, and I know thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
When I was a kid, my daddy, every morning at 6:30 on the nose, would get out of bed. And he walked down the hallway and sing Reveille. That was not a good moment. Then he would come by and he'd say, I want to hear your feet slap the floor, men. And me and my brother, not being men at the time, would never slap the floor. Then he would come in and pull the sheets off the bottom of your feet and start slapping your feet. Then you got up. That's just the funny part. But then one day we go in and he'd shave and he'd whistle this tune every morning. Boy, I hear my daddy whistle one more time, the old rugged cross. And people say, why do these old songs mean so much? People say, oh, I like the new music. Well, I like the new music too. That's okay. But daddy never whistled. Chris Tom. I never stood at my grandmother's skirt and heard her sing that, but I heard her sing this song. That's why I love it. Every song has a story. So y'all sing this song with us. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. The emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best, for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross, till my throat is at last.
Is at last I lay down.
still stands upon the hill of eternity. And Father, this still lights the way to each and every one of us for our salvation. Father, we thank you for what that cross means, that cross that stands for the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the victory that is found in Christ. Lord, we thank you for the ability to gather together this morning. Plead the blood over this church. And Father, I ask you to have a ring of protection around it, around the pastor. Lord, as he comes to lead the message, Father, that what he says will be heard, taken to heart. Father, we ask you to take this offering, bless the gift and the giver. We love you, we praise you, we magnify you, and you are why we sing in Jesus' name.
Good to see you this morning again. Thank you, Brother Michael, for being here with us. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn to Matthew chapter number 1. Matthew chapter number 1. We'll begin verse 23. And I'm just saying we're going to begin with a quick video. And shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. The title of our message this morning is In the Valley. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you thankful for what we've already experienced here, Lord, with some great hymns, some great music, Lord, that are just filled with truth. Truth that we need to be reminded of. We are filled with love for you this morning. Lord, I pray for the message. Be with me as I bring it. Lord, help us to really learn who you are. Learn attributes of you. And what does that mean, Lord, when you tell us that you're with us? Because we need to hear that as people. So, Father, I pray that you would fill us with that spirit, not just today, but over the next month as we delve into your word. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So for those of us this morning here who are Christians, it's easy to believe that God is with us on the mountaintops, right? And when we talk about mountaintops, we're talking about when life is going good. These are the good times. These are the good things. It's easy for us when things are going good in this life to say, God is great, God is with us, God is always here. But what about maybe you get a raise? You get a raise at work. We all like that, right? Everybody likes to get a raise. And when we get a raise at work, it's easy to say, man, God is on my side. God is with me. Look at me. He's blessing me. I'm getting more money. How about when your favorite team wins? Marshall University wins a football game on Saturday. It's easy for me to say, praise God. God's blessings are on that team. Life is good. He is with them. How about this for those of us who have kids, younger kids now, even if your kids are grown, you can remember this. When your kids finally started sleeping through the night for the first time. first time. No waking up, none of that nonsense. You thought, man, God is real, God is here, and God is for me, right? We praised Him in those times. Maybe you get a great parking spot. You're driving to Walmart, you're going to Publix, wherever it is, and you're tired, you don't feel like walking, you have to park in the back like you always have to do. And man, you pulled in, and right there, it was like listening with like angelic lights on it. It was ordained for you that very first slot to park your car in. It was calling your name. God is good, right? On the mountaintops. But what about the valleys? What about those valleys in life, the hard times, the difficult times? That's where it gets hard for us as believers. There was a doctor who was having a conversation with his patient in the office one day, and the doctor looked at the patient and he said, well, you know, I'm just going to tell you, I've got bad news and I've got worse news. The patient's like, oh, well, that's the worst thing that you want to hear at the doctor. Okay, let's just have it. Go ahead, give me the bad news first before I hear the worst news. Doc said, okay, well, the bad news is this, you only have 24 hours to live. You can imagine this was startling, this was stunning for the patient to hear. And he said, well, doc, if that is the bad news, I can't imagine what in the world could be worse than that. Well, the doctor said, the worst news is, I forgot to tell you yesterday. But it's in those valleys. It's in those valleys where you feel alone. Anybody ever felt alone in here? Yeah. That's hard. In those valleys where you feel scared. And would have been scared? Oh yeah. It's hard. It's in those valleys where you're hurting, where you're struggling. You don't see hope. You don't see a way out. It's in those valleys where you receive the bad news in your life. Whatever it is, I can remember I shared this before, but when I was going through my blood disease and going through all of the visits and the infusions, and we went to a hematology oncology center, so they dealt with blood diseases as well as cancers. I can remember sitting in the exam room waiting for my doctor to come in. The walls were thin, and I can remember hearing my doctor, Dr. Lang, being in the other rooms, and I could hear the exact conversations that were going on, but I can remember sitting there waiting for him to come in and hearing him talk, and then there'd be quiet, and then just hearing weeping, hearing crying, hearing the pain. And what I can only assume that people on the other side of the wall from me were receiving some of the worst pain in their entire life. Folks, let me tell you, that's the valley. That's the valleys. That's difficult. Some of you here this morning, your marriage is struggling. Let me tell you, you're in a valley. Others here this morning, your kids are struggling. And it doesn't matter if your kids are elementary age or if your kids are in their 40s, but they're struggling. And it breaks your heart. You're in a valley. Some of you here this morning, your walk with the Lord is struggling. You've not been as close to Him as you want to. There's been a distance. Maybe you don't have a relationship with the Lord. And you know it. You desire that. Let me tell you this morning, you are in a valley. Others of you here this morning, you've just been thrown a major life curveball. You got terrible news. Something didn't go the way you expected it. Something didn't go as planned. Something just uppercutted you across the chin. Let me tell you this morning, you're going through the valley. You say, Pastor, you keep talking about valleys. What are valleys? Valleys are this. Valleys are battles that we go through in life. Valleys are bouts of loneliness that we deal with when we feel like we don't have a friend, when we feel like nobody's got our back, when we feel like there's no way out of our situation. Valleys are times of desperation, where we're desperate for answers, and we can't seem to find one. That's a valley. So why go through valleys? More importantly, why would God have us to go through them? Are there benefits to valleys? Yes, there are. Number one, you will grow in a valley. Number two, you will build your faith in a valley. And number three, you will experience God in a completely different way in a valley than you would on a mountain. I want you to listen to this. We may enjoy God on mountaintops, but we get to know Him intimately in the valleys. Let me say that again. We may enjoy God on the mountaintops, and we do, right? We're thankful for Him. We're thankful for the blessings. We praise Him and we give Him glory. But that
that's not where I get to know God. I get to know God down here when times are hard, when I'm feeling pain, when I'm struck. That's where we get to know Him intimately, is in those valleys. Church, let me tell you this morning, because we just read that verse, Emmanuel. Jesus is truly Emmanuel. Jesus is God with us. There's no other life, there's no other source, there's no other solution. God with us is Emmanuel. So what does that name Emmanuel, God with us, truly show? Let me give you a few things. Number one, it shows how low God bent down to save man. Remember, He created man. He created us perfect. We had everything. We had heaven on earth. No sin, no sorrow, no pain, no crying, no hardships, no sickness. We messed it up. We sinned. No hope. Totally depraved. But God, but God, but God, He bent down low so that we didn't have to all be cast away into hell. He added the nature of one of His own creatures to His own divine nature, accepting the weaknesses, accepting the frailties, accepting the dependency that this creature experiences. Here, Jesus Christ is in heaven, perfect with His Father. But because we messed up, there had to be a solution. We can't earn our way into heaven. So here comes Jesus, volunteering, saying, I'm going to take on flesh, just like they did. I'm going to go down and struggle on earth with many of the same things that they struggled with. Yet praise God, He was without sin. He couldn't be capable of sin. Amen. Number two, it shows what a great miracle it was that God could add a human nature to His own and still remain God. The fact that we have Emmanuel, God with us, what an amazing thing. You never see it in Scripture outside of Jesus Christ, that here He is perfect, holy, sinless, Son of God. Yet He took on a human nature and now literally became the God-man. What an amazing thing. God with us shows the compatibility between the unfallen human nature and the divine nature. That the two can be joined shows that we are truly made in the image of God. And lastly, it shows that we can come to Him. If He has come to us, then we can come to Him. Charles Spurgeon says this, that if Jesus Christ be God with us, let us come to God without any question or hesitancy. Whoever you may be, you need no priest or intercessor to introduce you to God, for God has introduced Himself to you. What a privilege that is. We talked in our Sunday school class this morning about prayer. What is prayer? Why do we pray? Do we need to pray? Prayer is such an amazing thing that none of us take advantage of like we should. Literally, I can go to God with what is on my heart. I don't have to go to a priest. I don't have to go to a man. You don't have to go to your pastor to be able to go with the Lord. I can come literally, Scripture says, boldly to the throne of Christ. And I can get on my knees and I can share with Him and give Him and leave with Him who is ever on my heart. That is the privilege of God with us. So talking about the valley this morning briefly, let me give you three things that we must do for God to help us in the valley. Because here's the deal. God wants to help you in your valley today. He's not forgotten you. He's not forsaken you. He's not left you out to dry. You're in the valley. God wants to help you. But we've got to do some things to allow that. Number one, we've got to seek His strength. Seek His strength. Turn in your Bibles to Psalm chapter 84. And we'll be spending the rest of our time this morning in the book of Psalms. Psalm chapter 84. We're going to read three verses in this chapter here that perfectly describe the valley experience. Psalm chapter 84. Beginning in verse 5. Scripture says this, blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, and whose heart are the ways of them, who passing through the valley of Baca make it a well, the rain also filleth the pools. They go from strength to strength, every one of them in Zion appeareth before God. And so you see mention here of a valley, an actual valley. And David comes here and talks about the valley of Baca. What is this valley?
valley, what do we need to know about it? It really was a physical valley. It was a valley that takes place in what is modern-day Palestine. And it was desert country. It wasn't a place that you wanted to be. It wasn't a place that was desirable. The Valley of Baca is known for being full of thorns, being full of wild animals, being full of vipers, venomous snakes. There's all kinds of cats that live there that are very deadly and dangerous. It was not a place that you would want to get stuck in for very long at all, because there's no chance of human life there. The other thing about the Valley of Baca is it's nearly impossible to travel through it without facing trouble and hardship. So if you know, wherever your journey is taking you, that you've got to go through the Valley of Baca, you know there's going to be trouble coming. You know there's going to be hardship. This is not going to be a walk in the park. You're not just going to cruise. This isn't one of the beautiful valleys that we think of, right? Flowers and greenery and like you see in paintings. No, this is awful. And you know if you had to travel through there, that it was going to be difficult. The Valley of Baca is also known as these things: the Valley of Tears. It's also known as the Valley of Weeping. And it's also known as the Valley of Lost Mountain. And I want you to notice what David comes there in verse 5 and he says. He says, "Blessed is the man whose strength is in thee." Let me tell you this morning, if you do not know God personally, all you're doing is using your own strength when you go through valleys. And we make this mistake as Christians. I know God personally, but how many times, maybe there's someone here who can relate with me, do we go through hardships and hard times, horrible things in life, but I'm not depending on God. I'm going through with my strength. I'm going through with my wisdom. I'm going through with my know-how. Here's the danger in that. When we go through things in life without God, what we have is all we have. I've only got so much energy. I've only got so much wisdom. I've only got so much strength. And when it runs out, it's gone. It's gone. What happens, those of us who have went through these things by ourselves, we've struggled from them, right? We get exhausted. You're physically exhausted. You're mentally exhausted. And we say this, I can't take it anymore. You ever said that? Anybody ever said it with me? I can't take it anymore. I can't do this anymore. I just want to be done. I can't stand it. Can't make it. Help me. Notice what that verse doesn't say there in verse 5. It doesn't say this. Blessed are those who can make it on their own. It's very important. It says, blessed are those whose strength is with thee. So maybe you're here like me this morning. You say, you know, I'm not weak. I'm incapable. I can't do it. You know what? You're right. Because I'm not supposed to go through the hardships of my life in my strength. I'm to depend on Him. Can I say, let me give you a little Bible fact. The Bible never teaches you to be independent. The world will teach you to do that today. The world will tell you, you need to be independent. You need to be a self-maker. You need to go out and do it on your own. You don't need to depend on anybody else. You don't need any help. Look at you. You're strong. Just a couple weeks ago, we talked about Laodicea. That's what they did. They were independent. The city was self-supporting. They didn't need help. They rebuilt it. And look where it got the church. Listen, the Bible never teaches us to be independent. Why? Why would God not want us to be independent? Here's why. Because you were created to depend on God. You understand that? You, as a human being, were literally created to depend on Almighty God. For some of us this morning, maybe that's a whammy, you know? But it's true. We're nothing without Him. I can accomplish nothing. I can't get anywhere in my life without Him. He literally created me, and He created you to depend on Him. Pastor, I'm weak. I'm weak. I don't even know if I have the strength to ask God for wisdom or know what to do. Listen, your weakness is good. Your weakness is good. You know why? Because where you are weak, He is His strength is made perfect. Listen to this for 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 9 says this, "For we are glad when we are weak and ye are strong. And this also we wish, even your perfection." So you know what we do with our weaknesses? I take it to God. I give it to Him. I get on my face with a friend. I say, I don't know what to do. I'm weak. I don't have the wisdom. I don't have the strength. I don't have the know-how.
don't know how to get through this. I don't see a light at the end of the tunnel. I need you, God. You understand when you do that, that's the strongest thing that you could possibly do in your valley. Why? Because when you're weak, his strength is made unto perfection. That's how God works. You want to see God at work? It's, I'm going to solve this myself, and I'm going to push through it, and we're going to handle it, and we're going to take care of business, Lord, because I know how to do it. I don't need you. I've been there, done that. Now, that's when you're at your weakest. So, number one, we've got to seek his strength. You need help from the valley. Seek his strength this morning. It's an infinite supply. He'll always refresh you. He'll always give you what you need. Point number two, the second thing we've got to do for God to help us in the valley is we've got to fix our heart. Fix your heart. Look at the end of verse 5. It says, in whose heart are the ways of them? And so blessed are those who have their hearts fixed toward God. Listen, we need to have our minds set on things above, not things below. Have you ever struggled with that? Man, I'm so worried about the things going on in my life. I'm so worried about things going on in this world. I'm stressed out about things going on in this country and my problems and my brother's problems. Did you know what I haven't thought about all day? I haven't thought about him. I haven't thought about things above, things perfect, things heavenly. Philippians 4:8 says this, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are wise, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. Do you know what was missing from that verse? World problems. Do you know what else is missing from that verse? My problems. Do you know what else is missing from that verse? Everything that you're going through as well. Why? Because my mind doesn't need to be focused here. My mind needs to be focused here. My heart needs to be fixed on God. You say, Pastor, are you saying that what I think about, what my thoughts are, what goes through my brain actually matters? It actually affects me? It absolutely does. What you think about matters. Has anybody ever had trouble sleeping? Maybe your spouse or somebody rolls over and talks to you and you've actually uttered these words, I can't sleep. Has anybody ever said that? Can't sleep. I can't sleep. Don't say that. Do you know why? Because when you think it, how many of us, after we've said, I can't sleep, has actually fallen asleep without taking medication? Anybody? No. Why? Because what we think about matters. And so when I give into that and I say, I can't sleep, guess what? I'm not going to sleep. My current circumstances, your current circumstances this morning, maybe in the valley, that might be where you are. So if your circumstances are in the valley, make sure your heart is fixed on God. Maybe this morning your soul is aching. You're full of pain. You're full of bitterness. You're full of heartache. Listen, your heart has to be fixed on God. You may be here this morning and say, my emotions are racing. I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to think. But my heart is fixed on God. You may say, I've just got too much to do. There's too much on my plate. I'm overwhelmed with life. Maybe your marriage is in a bad place today. I don't see any hope with it. I don't know what's going to come from that. But maybe you're struggling with your in-laws. We just got through Thanksgiving, right? We're getting ready to go into Christmas. This is definitely an in-law type time for those of us who have one. Maybe you're saying, I just struggle with that relationship. Some of you are struggling financially this morning. Christmas isn't a good time. Why? Because we're worried about paying for it all. How am I going to pay for Christmas? How am I going to pay for all of these things? How am I going to make my bills? Nonetheless, our attitude needs to be the same. My heart is fixed on God. Worrying will not get me anywhere. Fretting will not get me anywhere. But when my heart is fixed on God, I remember the one who will get me somewhere. I remember the one who will take care of me and get me through it. Look at verse 6 with me again. It says, in passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well. The rain also filleth the pools. I want you to notice the wording in that verse. Do you notice there that they were passing through the valley? It says they were passing through the valley of Baca. Listen, you may be in the valley today.
You may be literally in the valley of Baca in your own life, but I want you to remember this. You don't live there. Scripture doesn't even say that he stopped there. We don't linger there. We don't set up tent there. The valley of Baca is not a permanent stop for us. Why? Because we're just passing through. The valley is not your final destination. Listen, as a believer this morning, I know that God's plan for my life is not to keep me in the middle of the valley. It's not where he wants me. God's got great things planned for my life. As a believer, God's got great things planned for your life. You're going through a hard time. Maybe you've been going through a hard time for a year. Can I remind you of this? You do not live in a valley. We're just passing through. Don't stop there. Don't set up camp there. Don't linger there. Don't try to throw a party there. Get out of the valley. We've got to keep getting through it. Psalm 23, many of you can probably quote this by heart, but you'll recognize this verse right off the bat. And verse 4 says something like this: though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, does that sound familiar to everybody? Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Many times in the valley, what do we say? I said, I just want out. You ever said that? Man, get me out of here. I just want out. Lord, just pluck me up and take me out. I am done with this. Moving on, just rescue me out of this. Here's what we've got to remember. The way of escape from your valleys is not out, but going through. Got to get through it. I know it's hard to hear. It's hard to say. But the way to get rescued from your valleys is not for God to pick you up and take you out of there. But you've got to get through it. He's wanting to teach you things. Look at verse 7. Verse 7 mentions Zion. You see that there in verse 7? It mentions Zion. What is Zion? Let me tell you this. Zion is where David wanted to get to. For those of you in your valley right now, or you will be in your valley, Zion is where you want to get through. Get me out of the valley of Baca and get me on to Zion. What is that? Zion is another name for Jerusalem in Scripture. Here are some names for Jerusalem. Jerusalem was known as the house of God. Jerusalem was known as the city of refuge. Jerusalem and Zion was known as the place of peace. I think this is interesting. In order for David, in order for you, in order for me to get to the city of refuge, they had to travel through the valley of tears. In order to get to the city of refuge, they had to travel through the valley of tears. And for many, the valley is the pathway to the place of peace. You're struggling, you're going through hard times, you're in your valley, don't give up. Don't quit. God's not left you, he's not forgotten about you, he's got the city of refuge waiting. But you got to get through that nasty valley in order to get there. Verse number 3, and we'll be done, or excuse me, point number 3, and we'll be done. You need to dig a well. Dig a well. Verse 6 again. Who passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well. The rain also filleth the pools. When you're in a dry place, you know, maybe some of you have been to the desert. I've been to the deserts of New Mexico. And it's a pretty dry place out there. You get out and there's no cell phone service. Your GPSs will glue where you're at times. And there's definitely no water. We can get in those places in our life, but it's dry. There's no water. I'm thirsty. I'm struggling. I'm exhausted. I'm dying. If you were in a desert, what would you do to try to find water? Well, you dig a small hole. You try to find water under the ground. You would dig a well. This is exactly what we've got to do in our life. Are you in that dry place and you're struggling? And David's coming here and he's saying, dig a well. Talks about a container to catch the rain. Listen, if it starts raining in the desert, I don't know how often it would happen, but you need to have some holes ready to catch that water, such as the same in our life. God is saying this, show me your faith, and I will show you my faithfulness. Show me your faith, and I will show you my faithfulness. Jesus in the New Testament came across a man who had a messed up hand. It says his hand was withered up, so his fingers didn't work. It was probably all shriveled up, and Jesus came across this man, and this man knew who Jesus was, and he knew that Jesus could heal him, and he called upon Jesus to heal him. Savior, will you fix my hand? It's withered up. Look at it. I want you to notice what Jesus didn't do. Jesus didn't just come to him and say, Jesus' power, you're healed. He didn't do that. No, he said something to him. He said this, stretch forth thy hand. He wanted that man to show him some faith. He's basically saying, you say I'm Jesus, you believe I'm the Savior of the world, you believe that I can heal you, show me your faith. If you think I can do it, stretch forth thy hand. The man did it, and Jesus healed him. Another time, Jesus came across a man who was lame. He means he couldn't walk. He hadn't been able to walk in 38 years. And this man is on the side of the road, and Christ comes, and he calls out on Jesus, and Jesus said, no, you can heal me. Again, Jesus didn't just say, okay, you're healed. And he walked on. Oh, he said something to this man. He said, get up and walk. You say I'm Jesus. You say I'm the healer. You will say that you believe that I'm God. Show me your faith. And I will show you my faithfulness. That man stood up for the first time in 38 years and walked using his legs. But yet buried in this passage of pain is also a promise. If you dig it, God will fill it. Now everybody's going back to the field of dreams right now, right? Everybody see that? If you build it, it will come. Yeah, we're not talking about that. That's where my mind goes to. But I want you to remember this. If you dig it, God will fill it.
Amen.
Go fill it. What does that mean, Pastor? What's he talking about? Well, it means this. If you draw near to me, I'm going to draw near to you. You need to be close to him. Go to him. Don't expect him to come to you. You will run to him. What does it mean? It means if you seek me, you will find me. You need to find God this morning. Then seek him. Look for him. I don't care what page you got to turn. I don't care who you got to get to. If you seek him, you'll find him. What else does it mean? It means this. If you make room for me, I will reveal myself to you. Many times in our life, we just don't make room for God. I don't have time to live in obedience. I don't have time to do what he's asked me to do. He's saying, you make room for me. I will reveal myself to you. We have to make time for God. Listen to this. God rarely reveals himself when you are rushed. How many times have we done this in our Christian life? I know I should be praying, and I'll say grace over my food, or I'll maybe say a quick prayer in the car or something. And I know I need to read my Bible, and so I'll just skim through it real quick. I don't really get much out of it, but I'm just going to skim so I can check it off the box, or I just don't read it at all. Has God ever spoke to us and done wonderful blessing in our life when we live like that? No. No, why? Because we've got to make time for God. There's a reason. Scripture says this, be still and know that I am God. I can't know that he's God if I'm not still. And you ever see it, we get still because we tell our kids all the time, sit still, right? But we can sit still and still be busy. We can sit still and still be doing things, and my mind is going, and I'm still fretting, and I'm still worried about this, and I'm still trying to handle this and that and all the others. No, you're seeing what that interpretation of be still means? That means all those distractions that have been weighing you down, all of those worries, all of those anxieties, all of those fears that you've been dealing with, shut them down. All of those distractions that come into your life, the busyness, all of your tasks and everything, put them on hold. Why? Because I get to be still and get along with him to know that he is God. And let me tell you something. When we do that, you better prepare for the presence of God. Because he is going to show up and he's going to do amazing things in your life. This is why as parents, it's probably not a great time to have a prayer life when the kids are out looking around. It's probably not the best time to get and have solemn prayer closet type fervent prayer with God while we're on the shop floor doing what it is that you do at work because it's so crazy and it's busy. Scripture says, be still, be still, be still. Get away from everything and know that he is God. God never says you won't go through the valleys. We have a hard time with that. And I wish I could give you different news. But there is nowhere in Scripture that says we will not go through hard times. We will not go through the valleys. But it does say this, that you never have to go through the valleys alone. Can I tell you something as a believer we should never feel is alone? We do, because the devil wants you to feel alone.
He wants you to feel like nobody's got your back. He wants you to feel like you're wrong. He wants you to feel like you are on an island by yourself. But God is with you. That's what Emmanuel means. God with us. So it's dark for you today. Maybe there's a storm coming on your horizon today. Maybe there's trouble brewing in your life today. Maybe you feel weak. Let me remind you of this. He is your light in darkness. He is your peace in the midst of that storm. He is your joy in the midst of all that trouble that you're going through. And He is your strength when you're weak. We're going to close with one more passage. You'll turn over to Psalm chapter 139. Psalm chapter 139. Verse 7, are you there? Psalm chapter 139, beginning verse 7. It says this, "Whither shall I go from my spirit, or whither shall I flee from my presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning, and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me." So let me tell you something this morning, Christian. Enjoy Him in the mountain. You're not wrong for that. We love the good times in our life. We love when things are going right. We love when things are going easy, and we can praise Him and glorify Him, and He's worth it, and He's worthy of it. But get to know Him. Where does the growth in our Christian life happen? It's not in the good times. It's when I'm struggling. It's when I'm suffering. It's when I don't know what to do or if I'm even going to make it. That's where we get to know Him. Seek His strength. Fix your heart. Give it well. In 1924, there were two climbers who were part of an expedition. They set out to conquer Mount Everest. Many of you have heard Mount Everest stories, and you've heard of time after time people have attempted to conquer that. Countless lives have been lost as people tried to climb that mountain. And as far as is known, these two climbers who went there in 1924, they never did reach the top, and they never returned. So somewhere on that gigantic mountain, they were overpowered by the elements and ultimately died. Their bodies have still to this day never been recovered. But after the failure of that expedition, the rest of the party who stayed with them at base camp didn't go up on that, but were with them and traveled there with them, did return home back to England. And addressing at a meeting in London, one of those who returned described that ill-fated adventure, and he turned to a huge photograph that was mounted on the wall behind him, and it just happened to be Mount Everest that they put up there for that press conference. And he started screaming at this picture on the wall, and he said this, he said, "Everest, we tried to conquer you once, but you overpowered us. We tried to conquer you a second time, but again, you were too much for us. But Everest, I want you to know that we are going to conquer you, for you can't grow any bigger than we can." Christian, non-Christian, let me tell you this. You will face Everest in this life. You will. Here's the one thing. There's one thing to take away. I want you to take away this. You will not conquer them without Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You will. You have to have Him. Believers, we know that, right? But we stray. Lost person who may be here, if you do not know Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're going to struggle. Listen, you have no advocate. You have no outlet. Literally, when you say there's no light at the end of the tunnel, right now in your life, there isn't. But can I tell you, there is one that exists. His name is Jesus Christ. He died for sinners. And encompasses me and everyone else in this room. You do not have to face that Mount Everest alone. You do it with Him. Do you have Him today? Do you know Him today? You see, I grew up in church, and I know the stories, and I've heard about Jesus, and I know, yeah, I know, but do you know Him? Know Him? Do you have a personal relationship? Has there ever been a time in your life where you've gotten your face before God and you repented of your sin? You said, "Lord, I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. If I were to die today, I would die and go to hell. I need you to save me from my sins. And I turn from my sins." Have you ever done that? It's not enough just to know of Him. You've got to know. half the non-Christians who are here struggle for a long time. Our relationship's not what it should be with God. My family's a mess. My marriage is a mess. Nothing's in order in my life. My finances are just out of whack. Maybe I've even thought about suicide. Yes, Christians can commit suicide. Maybe you just want it out. Remember, it's not out that gets you out of that issue. It's getting you through. Jesus has never left you. He's with you. He's growing you. He's building your faith. And he'll be with you until we're with him in all of glory. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful this morning. Lord, every one of us in this building this morning, we have failures, we have weaknesses, we have shortcomings. We're nothing without you, God. Lord, for those of us who are just like me in here, we've gone through so many times in our life trying to get through things in my own strength, trying to get through things in my own wisdom, trying to get through things in my own power. And every time I get the same result, I'm empty. I'm running on E. Lord, I ask that you could forgive me of that. Lord, when valley and bottom comes in my life, help me to seek your strength. Help me to rely on you. Help me to fix my heart on you, the only one who can pull me through the valley. Lord, help me to dig those wells in my life, that when you come raining down with all of those things that I need, that I'll be filled with them. I don't want to go through a dry desert all alone. Lord, if there's anybody here who this morning have to say, you know what, I've never given my life to Jesus Christ. I've lived on my own. I've done what I wanted to do. I've done that independent thing the Bible preaches against. My entire life has been a valley of rock. I'm done with it. I'm ready to have my wells filled. I'm ready to be able to depend on the Almighty Creator of the world. Lord, this morning I ask that you would give them repentance in their heart. Lord, that they would be able to humble themselves to say, I am nothing without you. Lord, I need you. Would you come into my life? Save me. Change me. Help me to live for you. Help me to follow you. Why? Because nothing else matters. Lord, we're so grateful today for what you've done for our church and what you've done for us. Lord, we're just indebted to you. Lord, I pray that all across this room, hurting hearts will be healed. Hopeless hearts will have hope again. Troubled hearts will be filled with joy. Lord, help us to acknowledge that that only comes with you. And all of these things we ask in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to play some music this morning. This is our invitation time. If you've got some things on your heart and you want to get alone before God, we have a makeshift altar here. You come take care of it before the Lord. No one's going to embarrass you or pull you down the aisle to do that. For those of you who want to take care of that, you see, that is perfectly fine as well. Here's what I don't want. I don't want anybody to leave out of here with any heart this morning. I don't want anybody to walk out of here with questions about where I would go if I were to die today. Or the direction that I need to take my family, or the direction that God wants me to live in my life. You don't have to live with questions. God has provided the answers for you. And we got to give it to him. Every head bowed, every eye closed, as we're going to just take a few moments of personal prayer here. If you feel led, please come forward, but please do not feel pressured.
Thank you.
Hey, I've got some exciting news today. We've got Scott and Kay and Dan. I don't know if you and Gloria are able to. She stepped out with the kids. But we have had two families come forward here the last couple weeks, and their desire is to become members of our family here at Faith Baptist Church. And so I am just excited as all get out about this. And so Scott and Kate come, and yeah, if you guys wouldn't mind staying, you don't have to, because some people get embarrassed. But I have been talking with them. I have learned to love this family. They're going to be wonderful here with us. And so Brother Scott is going to come by baptism. Miss Kay is going to come by statement of faith. And so what we need to do as a church here is vote them in as members, and we are willing to accept them here at Family of Faith Baptist. I'll raise your right hand and say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. And we got Gloria and Dan, if you guys would come ahead here. And they've got three precious little girls who are out there in the lobby. And the kids, and we've been got to know these guys very well, and awesome people. He's another fellow brother in blue, like me here, but they are coming to join as well. And so Brother Danny is going to join by way of baptism as well. And I believe we're going to do statement of faith with you. We'll check with Fuel Church. Fuel Church is where they're coming from. But they are also requesting membership into Faith Baptist Church. So by way of hand, raise your right hand and say amen. If you would accept
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. All right, guys, welcome to the family. I'll go ahead and dismiss you out to the lobby.
Thank you.
Yeah. Joseph, the life. Guys, come here. The thing is still on.
What are you doing?
The thing is still on. The thing is still on. It's recording still.
Hey, buddy.